Reddington, you may proceed whenever you're ready.
Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the court. Certainly Jane Roe brought her suit. As soon as she knew she was pregnant, as soon as she had sought an abortion and been denied, she came to federal court.
In 1970, a young Texas lawyer named Sarah Weddington, representing a certain Jane Roe, began arguments to the U.S. Supreme Court to strike down the Texas law against most abortions. The court decided Roe versus Wade in 1973, but ignited a national battle that continues today.
I suddenly realized that it was a child. It wasn't tissue, it wasn't a lump. Plus, I'd worked in an abortion clinic, and I had seen the freezer of dead babies.
22 years after Roe versus Wade, Jane Roe had seen enough of abortion. Her name is Norma McCorvey, and her message has definitely changed.
Roe versus Wade was probably the closest thing that made me feel like a human being. That's sad. To think that the next three generations of children that come after you are being aborted, that is nothing to be proud of. All I was just a simple little girl from Louisiana who thought she knew what she wanted. They wanted to change a law. I wanted to have an abortion. They said, Norma, don't you want to exercise your rights by having control over your own body? Yes, I said. Well, all you have to do is sign here on this dotted line. I signed it March the 7th, 1970.
Norma's signature made her Jane Roe in a class action lawsuit. Unwed and pregnant for a third time, she felt desperate. Her mother had adopted her first baby against her wishes, and Norma made sure she didn't get her second child.
Gave her up for adoption. A couple of years later, got pregnant again. Didn't want to have it. Didn't want it in my body. I wanted to kill it. I wanted to have an abortion. I went to an illegal abortion clinic in Dallas. I had $250 of my rent money saved up. There was nobody there. Well, I went to this attorney. And he treated me pretty much like a word I can't say anymore. He said that he just knew of these two young law students who had just graduated college, Sarah Weddington, Linda Coffey, and that they were trying to challenge the Texas statute on abortion. I mean, it just went right over my head. I mean, I didn't have a clue to what he was saying. And would I like to meet these two women? Sure. We sat and talked and drank beer for the longest time. We got kind of smashed. Then we had pizza. Then we drank some more beer. And they started pounding, you know, all this, well, don't you think women should have the right to control their own body? Yeah. They never said anything about, it's really a baby, Norma. You're going to be killing your baby. Don't you know that you're signing an affidavit to execute the next three generations of children to come? They didn't say anything like that. I didn't have a clue. I was ignorant. I mean, I was dumb. I was the girl from the wrong side of the tracks. I was one of those girls that other mothers told their daughters about to stay away from. That's who I was. I thought just by one thread, just by one small, minute thread, that they could help me. Sarah said that she was going to call a doctor friend of hers that she knew who did abortions that were still illegal, but he had been aborting women for over the last couple of years. I'm going, groovy, cool. I knew it wasn't ever gonna happen because I knew she wasn't never gonna keep her word. You know things like that. I gave birth to my third baby June 2nd of 1970. The baby had been born maybe 4 months. Sarah called me up from Washington, said that she was going to the Supreme Court of the United States the next day, and that she wanted to talk to me. Would I like to go to Washington? And I said, excuse me, Sarah, but I had a baby. I had my baby, man, and she wasn't there. She said she'd be there. She said she'd take care of it. She said that everything was gonna be okay and that it'd be all right. She wasn't there, man. Things weren't all right. Things weren't okay. Things got progressively worse and worse and worse. It was smoke, 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 pot, 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 take pills, drop acid, do masculine, do anything you can get your hands on. That was pretty much how I wanted to stay all the time. Just stoned. Don't think, don't eat, don't act, don't even have to breathe. Because it hurts too bad. Just hurts. Every time you turn around, there's someone there. They've shaken your hand with one hand and they're stabbing you in the back with the other. And you just get damn tired of it.
While Norma never had an abortion, her lawsuit opened the floodgates. On January 22, 1973, Roe v. Wade overruled every state restriction and made abortion on demand the new law.
It might have been a victory for Weddington and Coffee and for all the other pro aborts, but it was shame. For me, the definition for abortion hit me in the face. I could see little babies being pulled out of their mamas, but they were alive. That's what I lived with for the better part of 14 years.
By the spring of 1995, Norma was working at this abortion clinic in Dallas called A Choice for Women. The years of drugs, alcohol, and suicide attempts had taken their toll. But the clinic's new neighbors were about to challenge her in a way she'd never been challenged before.
What you're seeing